Iran celebrates the Islamic Revolution, and President Ahmadinejad says the world has affirmed the country's right to nuclear technology. The visiting U.S. Defense Secretary winds up his visit to Iraq as violence kills dozens in the occupied territory. Also in the news, East Timor's president is in serious condition following an attempt on his life in an apparent coup attempt.
Hello and welcome. It is 4:30 p.m. here in Tehran. You're watching Press TV World News. I'm Zarin Shajari.
And my name is Arash Zahidi. Thank you for joining us. Millions of Iranians have flooded the streets across the country to celebrate the 29th year of the Islamic Revolution. People took to the streets since the early hours of the morning to mark the country's greatest national event in cities all over the country. More than 600 Iranians and foreign reporters covered the event in the capital, Tehran, where up to 7 routes had been prepared for the rallies. Demonstrators chanted national slogans, including calls for the recognition of the right to nuclear technology. Similar rallies were held throughout the whole country.
Celebrations for the 29th anniversary of Iran's Islamic Revolution would not be complete without a tribute to the late founder of the Islamic Republic. Amir Mehdi Kazemi takes a look at what the great Imam Khomeini means to Iranians today.
He is known as the most charismatic figure in Iran's contemporary history. Grand Ayatollah Ruhollah Mousavi Khomeini, known as Imam or Great Religious Leader to many world Muslims even today. The man who led Iran's Islamic Revolution against the Pahlavi monarchy, bringing new ideas to build a good and strong Iran. Today, 29 years after the victory of Iran's revolution, Iranians celebrate the event from February 1st, the day the Imam returned to Iran in 1979, to February 11th, when the Iranian revolution declared its victory in the same year. The occasion is called the 10-day dawn, or Fajr.
Iranians saw in him a person who was in many ways an ideal personality, both as an educated person as well as a person who was willing to sacrifice for his ideas.
When Imam Khomeini returned to Iran after 14 years in exile, he was greeted by more than 5 million Iranian welcomers in Tehran alone, who had formed a 33-kilometer queue, one of the greatest welcome ceremonies in history. On the last day of the 10-day dawn, Iranians take to the streets across the country, remembering the day which marks Iran's real independence from dominance of the West and the Soviet Union over their country.
He showed Iranians that progress and liberation can be brought about through Islam. And Iran truly became the only independent country, I would argue, in the 80s in the world that was neither a client regime of the Western alliance or the Eastern bloc.
The name of Imam Khomeini has spread far and wide amongst people's mindsets for his leadership in a revolution that was the first to bring an Islamic government in the 20th century. Imam Khomeini's character as a revolutionary is the most known figure in his personality. He succeeded where many others had failed, fighting the most powerful ruler in the Middle East, the Shah, with a pen and a paper, what he referred to as his weapon. Amir Mehdi Kazemi, Press TV, Tehran.
In Tehran, President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad said his country considers its nuclear case closed as the world has affirmed Iran's right to nuclear technology. Addressing crowds in Tehran's Azadi Square, Ahmadinejad said Iran achieved its right through resistance. He said major powers have tarnished the reputation of the UN Security Council for unjustly punishing Iran. Ahmadinejad said reports by the UN Nuclear Agency and the U.S. intelligence services have proven that Western accusations were baseless. He criticized those powers that urged the UN to pursue its mistaken policies against Iran. The president said they should apologize to Iran and realize that it will not retreat in the face of threats and pressure. Ahmadinejad said Iranians will always oppose injustice because the Islamic Revolution is all about defending those that are oppressed.
Moving to Iraq, and after yesterday's deadly events, violence has flared again in Iraq for a second day running. Twin car bombs planted near a gas station in southeastern Baghdad have claimed the lives of 14 people. At least 45 people are also known to have been injured. The blast was powerful enough to blow a large hole in the road surface. Security sources say the apparent target of the attack was a building where anti-Al-Qaeda tribal leaders were meeting. The attack hit around 9 a.m. local time when U.S. Defense Secretary Robert Gates was due to wrap up a two-day surprise visit. Gates arrived in Iraq on Sunday, coinciding with a deadly bomb attack in Balad, northeast of Baghdad, which killed at least 34 people. Elsewhere, one U.S. soldier was killed in a roadside bombing in Diyala province.
Meanwhile, the U.S. invasion of Iraq has created a serious humanitarian crisis. Iraq's infrastructure needs to be rebuilt as well. Amanda Lindhout reports from Baghdad.
Once called the land of dates and palms, Iraq is now the land of sewage and pollution. In September 2003, U.S. President Bush promised Iraqis he would restore basic services such as electricity and water. However, 5 years into the Iraq war, and electricity levels in Baghdad are at an all-time low. The city is drowning in sewage, thirsty for water, and largely powerless. Baghdad residents have become almost entirely dependent on expensive fuel-run generators to supply them with electricity.
Iraqi people suffering from electricity, which are the, one of the most important services to the human being now, only 1 hour daily. Iraqis people having electricity. Sometimes, I remember last month, only 3 hours monthly, we have electricity in our district. You can imagine. With this, weather and winters, very, very, very cold, you couldn't cook, or sometimes you couldn't also make a heating, and also a lot of other services.
The sewage system in Iraq has collapsed, with only one of three treatment centers in Baghdad functioning. The flow of sewage in the streets has created a foul lake large enough to be seen on Google Earth. All residents are threatened with waterborne disease, and health problems continue to escalate. Citizens must buy bottled water they cannot afford because the tap water is contaminated by sewage. The UNDP is working on the rehabilitation of the treatment plants, but insufficient funding and violence on the streets limits their progress.
This is an uncivilized situation. Firstly, the sewage is overflowing. We don't have any way to clean it. They have closed the sewage pipes because garbage stuck inside clogged them. No one has followed up with this.
The environmental damage will be felt in Iraq long after the conflict has ended. Dangerous pollutants are released during bombings, contaminating the soil, air, and freshwater resources. This is causing massive and possibly irreversible damage, according to environmental groups. Cancer rates among children in Iraq have reached unprecedented levels, and the World Health Organization says children are the most likely to feel the effects of the pollutants.
Bad infrastructure affected direct for so many pollution. They have the big problem. One of the problems is so many people been kidnapped. They are afraid to go send all those garbage out. And the other things that, as I mentioned in the beginning, there was in Iraq no any kind of environment policy.
The degradation of Iraq's infrastructure has reached critical levels since 2003. Without efforts to rebuild and maintain services like water supplies and electricity, experts say the humanitarian crisis in Iraq will hinder any efforts towards national reconciliation. This is Amanda Lintout, Press TV, Baghdad.
A local governor has survived a bomb attack in Afghanistan's Kandahar province. The bomb exploded by Asadullah Khalid's convoy and injured three civilians and three policemen. But Khalid was not wounded. He was on his way to give a speech at a development project. Two suspects have been arrested so far. Kandahar is the former stronghold of the Taliban. The province has been the scene of fierce fighting over the last 2 years.
Across the border, Pakistani security forces have killed a top Afghan Taliban commander in Pakistan's Balochistan province.